And we are looking at problem 29 on page 332. We're still in optimization, so let's read. A right circular cylinder is inscribed in a sphere of radius r. So here's the sphere. And here's the cylinder. We are given the radius of the sphere. I can show it anywhere. I'm going to show it here. So this is the radius given to us in the form of little r, lowercase r. Okay. Find the largest possible volume of such a cylinder. So find the largest volume of such a cylinder. Very good. What do I have to find for? I have to find something and find its maximum. So what is that something that I have to find?
Way to relate the radius to the
not
sphere.
Yet, not yet, not yet. So let's read the question one more time. Find the largest volume of such a cylinder.
You want to maximize the volume.
Exactly. So then in order to maximize a function, I have to have what first?
Derivative.
The true. You're right. In order to maximize a function, I have to have its derivative, but before I have its derivative, I have to have the function, correct, right? If I don't have the function, I will not be able to differentiate and I will not be able to find the maximum, right? Good. So first of all, I know now that I have to find a function that is the volume of the cylinder. Anyone remembers the volume of the cylinder, the formula? Careful, we're not talking about the sphere. One more time. No, that's the cone, please. Area of the base times the height. What is the area of a circle?
R squared.
I cannot use this R, though. I'm going to have to use an uppercase R. Pi R squared multiplied by? Yes, since I'm using an uppercase R, I'm going to use an uppercase H. And now I have to show you where they are. So this is what?
H.
Thank you. And this is what? Good. Yes, Joe, go ahead.
I thought your R was
I. Okay, good. Yes, go ahead.
Why do we have two radiuses?
One's the radius of the sphere, one's the radius of the cylinder. Because the cylinder is inside the sphere, it does not have the same.
Very good. I couldn't have said it better. Thank you. Okay. So now, obviously, I have to get rid of one of these two variables. Would you agree? I don't know in Calc 1, I don't know how to differentiate a function with two variables, correct? So somehow one of these two variables has to go away, and the function, which is the volume, will be of one single variable. It's a single variable function. Okay. So now let's look at what we have here inside. So if I cut the sphere right in the middle, then I would, and remove half of it, right? And I'm looking inside. I see something like this. I see R. I see the height. I see this little r, this uppercase r, I meant to say. And this is a piece that I don't know and I don't have. Right?
How did you cut the sphere?
The same thing as the big R. When we say that.
Say it again.
The line that you just drew up, like the last line that you just drew up. Like,
are you talking about this graph?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's do it here. So this is R.
Yeah.
This is R, lowercase r. Also, this here has to be lowercase r because it has to, yes, it has to touch, right? It has to touch the sphere inside. It's kind of hard to show. So this is r and this is r. And this is definitely h.
So what I'm saying is...
Yes, go ahead.
Like the line right in the middle of the...
You mean this piece?
No, that like the one that you just did.
This one.
Yeah, that one. Wouldn't we say
this is also R, yes.
R,
yes. Yes, yes, of course. Yes, you're right. Good. So this is R and this is R. And the height, so this is also R. This is the height, right? So this is uppercase R. This is lowercase r. This is lowercase r. This must be h divided by 2. And this must be h divided by 2. From here till here.
So no y.
Because I've denoted a by h, so it's h over 2. Very good. So we have to find the relationship now.
Hard to conceptualize.
Which part? So what I'm doing here is showing that this is h, this is r, and this is r. Of course, this is the radius of the cylinder. This is also the radius of the cylinder, and this is always also the radius of the cylinder. Is that okay? So now let's try to find the relationship between h and r, or r and r, only because I have to eliminate one of these variables. Either r or h has to go away. So I have that h divided by 2 squared plus r squared must equal lowercase r squared. Are you comfortable with this?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, but do we all agree? So this piece, which is h over 2, this piece, which is r, and this piece, which is lowercase r, which is the radius of the cylinder. You can also see it here, if this is better, right? R, h over 2, and uppercase r. Okay, so from this relationship, I will try to solve, I can solve for r squared. And if I don't write anything, I just need 1 second to see. So this is r squared plus minus h squared divided by 4. That is a good idea. Or I could solve this for h, but will give us a square root. And I think it's better to solve for r squared.
So you're saying if we solve for right triangle, we could solve for all of the right triangles in there?
No, all I'm saying is that I need the relationship between h and r.
Okay.
So then the volume now becomes a function only of h. It's pi. R squared is all this. R squared minus h squared divided by 4, everything multiplied by h. And I will continue with pi. I will distribute h inside. R squared times h minus h to the third divided by 4.
Does that still leave you with two variables, though?
No. R is given to us. R is the only known quantity that we are given. The only variable is uppercase H.
So
I'm sorry?
So V of H.
Yes.
And
so did that end up changing to be the R squared or that's what it's called?
I distributed H in here. H times R squared is this. H times this is H cubed over 4.
How did you get V of H? How did you get that?
What all that's going to be?
From here, I replaced R squared by this quantity.
Times H. Okay.
Times H. So now V prime of H will be pi R squared minus 3H over 4. 3H squared over 4. And now I will set equal V prime of H equal to 0. We know why, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So when I set V prime.
Okay, how did you differentiate that?
The only variable is H. That's why I put it in parentheses. When I differentiate this with respect to H, I get R squared. When I differentiate this with respect to H, I get 3H squared over 4. And now I set it equal to 0. Of course, I don't set equal to 0 this quantity, just this quantity. So R squared minus 3H squared over 4 must equal 0. I'm solving for H.
And you're given R, right?
Yes, that's the only thing we have. So I will multiply both sides by 4 over 3. So then H squared equals 4R squared over 3. And finally, I'm taking the square root. This one time, I will not write plus or minus. Normally, I should write plus or minus because I have to get two solutions. However, H is a height. So this is 2R divided by the square root of 3. You could rationalize. And this is 2R the square root of 3 over 3, if that's what you want. I claim that this gives a maximum volume, and I did not prove it yet, but I also have to determine R. I'm asked to find the largest volume of such a cylinder, but I have to find the radius also. I found the height, but I also have to find the radius. So I will plug it in here. I will plug the H in here. So then R squared equals R squared minus, I'm going to write 1 over 4 multiplied by H squared. So H squared I know is 4R squared divided by 3. I will simplify. So then R squared equals R squared minus 1/3 of R squared, so it's 2R squared over 3.
How'd you do that? Where'd you
R squared minus 1 over 3 R squared is 2/3 R squared.
No, on the top it says square root of H.
Yeah, I take the square root, H here, the square root of 4 is 2, the square root of R squared is R, the square root of 3 is the square root of 3.
Why do you multiply that?
Because I'm solving for H squared.
Okay, so you got H now.
So this is H. Not yet. I have to find R squared. Wait a minute. So then I take the square root. So then R is R the square root of 2 over the square root of 3. And I will rationalize by the square root of 3. So then R equals 2 the square root of 6 over 3. 2, not 2, R. How did I come up with 2? So these are the dimensions of the cylinder, and I claim that, and I will have to show, I have to find the volume. So the volume is pi r squared, here's my r squared, 2r squared over 3 times h, which is this, 2r the square root of 3 over 3. And this is V equals, so this is 4 pi divided by 9 R cubed the square root of 3. 2 times 2 over 3 times 3 is 4 over 9 pi and r cubed and the square root of 3. I claim that this is the maximum possible volume of the cylinder that is inscribed in the sphere with the radius r. I did not prove it, though. So I have to show that this is correct, that it gives a maximum. In order to do that, if you remember, I have to show that V prime of h and V of h. So this is at h, which is 2r the square root of 3 over 3. And I got the maximum to be 4 pi over 9 r cubed the square root of 3. I have to convince you that, and I haven't done it that yet, I have to convince you that this gives a maximum. So in other words, I have to show you the signs left and right for the first derivative. I'm going back to my first derivative. And because the leading coefficient is negative, the function is a function of h. R is known. So because the leading coefficient is negative, the function is quadratic, so it will have a maximum. So it will be positive between solutions and negative outside. So this is one solution, but the other one is outside of the domain. It's right here, negative. So in between solutions, it's positive, and outside is negative. You can also plug in 0. That's another option. When you plug in 0 here for h, then you are left with r squared pi, which is a positive number. So now it's guaranteed, and I proved it, that this gives a maximum. Because I studied the sign of the first derivative. Very good pick, Zach. Thank you for picking that. Very good pick. However, this situation is, I would say, slightly more complicated because it required, but let's summarize what we did also. So first of all, we were asked to find the largest volume of a cylinder. So we had to write the volume of the cylinder, when this is the formula. I can differentiate a function with two variables in this class. So one of these two variables has to go away. When looking inside here, I realized that this is the radius. This must be half of the height, which is h, and this must be the radius of the cylinder. And I use Pythagorean theorem, which is h over 2 squared plus r squared equals little r squared. And it was easier for me to solve this equation for r squared, so then if I solve it for h, then I will have a square root in here, which is slightly more difficult to differentiate. So it's r squared minus h squared over 4. I replaced it in here, which is this, and I distributed h, and now I was ready. I had a function that gave us the volume of the cylinder. Once I had that function, I was able to differentiate it because it's a function only of one variable. Once I differentiated, it was nothing. It was a quadratic function in h. Then I differentiated, I set it equal to 0 to find critical numbers. And I found the critical numbers, but actually I can only accept one because the other one will be negative because it's the height. So once I was done with that, then I went back to the Pythagorean theorem. I replaced h by what I obtained to get r. So that's what I did. I simplified. I combined like terms. I took the square root from both sides. Again, I was not able to write plus or minus. I cannot write plus or minus because the radius is a positive number. So I got r the square root of 6 over 3. And then I determined, because I was asked to find the maximum volume, this is the maximum volume, where I have pi. I have r squared, which is 2 r squared over 3, and I have h, which is this. When I put this together and simplify it a little bit, I got pi, I got 4, I got 9, I got r cubed, and the square root of 3. And this is not sufficient to tell you, hey, this is maximum volume. It's not sufficient. I have to convince you. So I plug in the first derivative, and I show that this is the correct sequence of signs. The first derivative is 0 here. This is the maximum volume, but I have to show that the sign changes this way. And now it's guaranteed that it is indeed a maximum. So when the height...
Well,
when the height is 2r, the square root of 3 over 3, and the radius is whatever we obtained, r the square root of 6 over 3, that gives the maximum cylinder that can be inscribed in the sphere. Very good example. Any questions on this problem?
Yes.
Go ahead. But if it's algebra, it has to wait till the end of the class. I'm going to sit down and talk about algebra.
Okay, wait. Can I see the algebra?
Yes. Thing? Yes. This page or the previous one?
Yeah, this one.
Okay.
What happened to you? When you have r, when you r squared equals stuff here, that one. R squared.
Minus.
Yeah,
okay.
Okay,
okay, okay. R squared minus 1 over 4 times h squared. Is this clear?
Yeah.
Good. R squared minus 1 over 4 times h squared. 4 r squared over 3. I simplify the 4. From 1, I subtract 1 over 3. And I get 2 over 3. From one integer, I subtract 1 over 3, and I get 2/3. And of course, r squared. Is that good? Good. Anything else? Very good question. Anything else? OK, let's look at other problems. Yes, let's look at problem 33 on page 333. The top and bottom margins of a poster are each 6 centimeters, and the side margins are each 4. If the area of printed material on the poster is fixed at 384 square centimeters, find the dimensions of the poster with the smallest area.
On the poster, you mean the frame?
Yes.
The frame
let's read the question one more time. Let's read the whole problem one more time. Very good question. Okay, let's read it. The top and, yes, Joe, go ahead. Please ask any question.
No,
he's informing me for the test on Tuesday.
Oh, okay. Yes, Johnny, hey, anything? I mean, even if we do this, I can stop if you have any questions.
I know, just tell me that.
That's fine, but if you have any questions about the material, because you came in late and I'd like to answer your questions. I mean, this can wait if you have you worked on anything that you want to see or...
No, fine.
You're okay? Okay. The top and bottom margins of a poster are each 6 centimeters and the side margins are each 4 centimeters. If the area of the printed material on the poster is fixed at 384 centimeters squared, find the dimensions of the poster with the smallest area.
First,
we have to give it some names, right?
Yeah.
I agree. Very good. So if I denote this by x, and let's say I denote this by y, what can you write immediately?
X times y.
Yes, I can write that x times y is?
384 centimeters.
Excellent. Perfect. But this is not what we are trying to determine. That is fixed, right? So what is the area of the poster then? Notice that I cannot put a particular variable because there are two variables involved.
X plus 8.
X plus 8. multiplied by?
Y plus 12.
That's it. Do you all agree with the area of the poster as being x plus 8 times y plus 12?
What happened,
please? Can anyone explain?
So we have the rate or the area of the inside, but we have to find the area of the whole poster. So we have to take the margins or the margins that they took out and include that in the whole measurement. So because each margin for the top and bottom are 6 inches or 6 centimeters, we have to add 12 because there's two of them. Same thing with the 4 centimeters.
Is this okay?
We're just finding the whole area.
Is that okay? Everyone?
Y plus 12 is 8.
The whole area. So the whole height.
And x plus.
So the area of the poster is this.
Why do we include the
x plus 8?
I just shaded in the area of the poster.
No, I'm just asking, why do we include the x plus? Why can't we just say
because we have more than eight. We have the whole inside.
That's just the frame. To add it together to find the total length.
We're finding the poster. And the poster is that.
The whole thing.
Yes. So when you buy a poster with somebody's, you know, right? It can have a margin. Right? So now we're talking about the poster itself. We're not talking about the printed area. We're talking about the poster. Okay, so obviously I'm going to distribute. Yes, John?
So just make it, sure
yes.
The 6 centimeters and the 4 centimeters is just the space between
the printed area and the edge.
It's a given.
So,
right? So
X is the middle.
X is this piece. And
okay,
you see
yeah.
Y is this piece.
Okay.
Okay?
84 is just the middle.
Yeah, the printed area. Should we read it one more time?
No, I got it.
Okay. So this is xy plus 12x plus 8y plus 96. Do we agree with this so far?
Yeah.
Well, obviously.
Yeah,
right. Obviously, this is given to us. So I have 384 plus 12x plus 8y plus 96. And I'm going to add the two numbers. So 12x plus 8y plus. 8, is it 480? Correct me if I'm not. If I'm mistaken?
Yes.
Okay, very good.
Where,
so now. It's right here. We are told that this is given to us. So x times y can be replaced by 384. We already established that here. It's given to us in the problem. Okay? So now I have a function, but it's still not a function of one variable. But I know that x times y is 384. So if I know that x times y equals 384, let's solve, let's say, for, bless you, let's say for, okay, 384 divided by x. And I will have to replace y by 384 divided by x. And now the function, which is the area of the poster, becomes a function of one variable. So this is 12x plus 8 multiplied by 384 divided by x plus 480.
Okay, so 8, and I guess y is 384 over x? I'm just
yes.
Where
you see it? What? It's given in the problem that x times y is 384. I can solve this equation for y.
Okay, you found that out. That would be important.
Yeah, it says
the
inner part is
the printed
area.
The printed area. It's given in the problem. You have to take some notes. You have to, because then if you don't take the notes or if you don't write, like I did, right? Then it's difficult to remember all these little pieces.
So the area of the poster, I understand how you got that.
Good. So now.
But when you put x, y, are you, that's inner. So are you subtracting
It doesn't
that?
Matter. It doesn't matter. Whenever I see x times y, I must replace it by 384. It's given in the problem. I have no choice.
I understand.
So I change.
But why do you have it there anyway? I mean,
x times y is xy, x times 12 is 12x, 8 times y is 8y, 8 times 12 is 96. I have to multiply to find the area.
Oh, and you already have hy.
Exactly.
Oh, okay.
Good. So then when I differentiate this, I have 12 minus 8 times 384 divided by x squared, and this is 0. What will happen next? What do I have to do next? Can anyone tell us? We had the function, we differentiated it, now what?
We have to
yes?
equal it to 0.
Excellent. Absolutely. So I have a prime of x equals 0, so I have 12x squared minus 8 times 384 divided by, I'm just lazy to multiply, it doesn't matter, I'm going to have to divide in a minute, so that's why I did not multiply. So this is the least common denominator is x squared. So then I have 12x squared. This has to be multiplied by x squared. 12x squared minus 8 times 384, everything over x squared is 0, only if the top is 0. So 12x squared minus 8 times 384 equals 0, which means x squared equals 8 times 384 divided by 12. So I can simplify by 4. And let me see if this is divisible by 3, 7, and 8. No, it's 15. Yes, it is. So then x squared, 1, 2, 8? 256. 1, 2, 6 times
3. I'm multiplying it.
No, that's okay. Am I correct?
Yeah.
128. So then x squared equals... 256. When I take the square root, I get that x equals? How much is that? We know that. Good, of course. 16 centimeters. Now, I claim that the dimension of the poster will be x plus, right? The dimension of the poster would be x, which is 16, plus 4 and 4. So the width will be 24. And I have to determine why.
Why was it 12x squared minus the 8 times 300?
I'm sorry?
Can you go over what page? The 12 minus.
Yes.
The 8 times 384 over x squared. Why is it minus?
We talked about that, if you remember, and I kindly asked you to remember that 1 over
yes,
x
okay.
prime is
yeah.
negative 1
okay.
over x squared. This is extremely important.
Sorry.
That's okay. That's okay. So please remember 1 over x prime is nothing else but x to negative 1 prime, which changes into negative 1 over x squared. Correct? Are we okay?
Mm-hmm.
Perfect. So now I have to determine y. So if anyone can divide 384 by 16 for me. So then y equals 24? 24 centimeters. I claim that the poster with the smallest area will be 16 plus, it was 8, right? 16 plus 8, I want to write like that so everyone can see, by 24 plus 12. So the poster with the smallest area will be 24 centimeters by 36 centimeters. But I have not convinced you that x equals 16 produces the smallest area yet.
Oh, yeah.
So, yes, so I have x, I have
sure
a prime of a, and I have a of a. So 16, 0. You can put 0 here if you want. So here's the derivative. Actually, I prefer this one because the denominator is always positive, and the numerator between solutions, which are negative 16 and positive 16, that will be minimum, a negative. Or you can plug in 0. When you plug in 0 in the top, you get a negative number. So this is definitely the minimum. And the minimum will be if you want to multiply 24 by 36. I forgot my calculator, but I have a calculator here. So then I'll put the 24 by 20 by 36. Anyone? Or I can do it.
24 times 36, you
say? Yes. The length times the...
864.
Very good. Squared centimeters.
Yes.
It says find the dimensions of the poster with the smallest area, and the dimensions are 24 by 36 guaranteed, and the smallest area will be 864 squared centimeters. Yes, please.
Can you move the paper?
Yes, this part.
Yes.
Yes.
So, right on the derivative where it says like 12x squared minus
yes.
8 times 3 over.
Yes.
X-squared.
Yes.
What did you do with that x squared on the bottom? Like,
what will I ever do with it when I solve this equation? This equals 0. What do I ever do?
Did you just multiply both sides?
You could, but the question
the
is.
The numerator has to be 0.
Right.
Zero.
When a fraction is 0, only the numerator can be 0.
So you just had to set the numerator to 0.
Exactly.
So you pretty much just said, like, you know, just got rid of that x squared. Like, we don't need that at all.
No. I asked myself, when is a fraction 0? When is a over b 0? Only when a is 0.
So I'm saying, like, after you did that, you didn't bring that back in. So, like, we don't need that really after.
Because I asked myself, when is a fraction 0? And the answer is, only when the numerator is 0.
Didn't you just cross multiply?
If you want. So when is this fraction 0? Only when the numerator is 0.
Okay.
Or you can cross multiply, or you can multiply both sides by x squared. However, I'm reluctant to say multiply both sides by x squared because x could be 0. Not in this case. You have to state a restriction. So yes, you can consider it as if we multiply both sides by x squared. That's fine too. But the easiest thing to do or to think about it is this. When is a fraction 0? Only when the top is 0. Okay, let's look at another problem. Let's research a little bit. Maybe yes, problem 19. On page 332. Find the point on the line y equals 2x plus 3 that is closest to the origin. So find the point on this line that is closest to the origin. Okay? How do I address that? What should I do first?
Plot the line.
Of course, graph the line. Absolutely. Good. So when x is 0, y is?
3.
Very good. So 0, 3. When y is 0, I move 3. It becomes negative 3. 3 over 2. Very good. Excellent. Negative 3 over 2. So negative 3 over 2, 0. That's all I need to graph this line. Very good. So, negative 3 halves, 0. Negative 3 halves, 0. And 0, 3. I can't make this stop, so I'm sorry about that. I don't know how to. It's Dan's fault. He made me upgrade the phone.
Persuade you, or did he?
No, he twisted my arm.
But he persuaded you.
Okay, so this is the line, and we're asked to find the point that is closest to the origin. So somewhere along this line, maybe a point here, maybe a point here, maybe a point here, maybe a point here, maybe a point here. I don't know where. but I have to find the point that is the closest to the origin. When I say closest, I'm the closest to which of these, of you, for example? Yes, because the distance between me and Zach is the smallest. The distance, then the distance between me and Dan, me and John, me and Joe, Eric and Ali, right? So I have to find a point on this line whose distance from zero is the smallest. I'm going to say it's a point. I don't know where it is. You can put it anywhere you want. It has to be generic. I'm going to say, I don't know, this point. Can anyone give us the coordinates of this point? Oh, no. Oh, no. So x, comma, perfect, which is what?
Why?
Which is? Indeed, 2x plus 3. So nobody can read it here. It's too close. So a of x, comma, 2x plus 3. Excellent. Can anyone give us the coordinates of the origin? Excellent. Can anyone now give us an expression for this distance? Please. Thank you. The square root of
y
x2 minus x1 everything squared plus y2 minus y1 everything squared. Very good. I have the distance between the point A and the origin. So if you want, you can write the distance AO from A to the origin. It's only one variable. So then I know that this is a function of x and one variable x. So then I have the square root of x squared plus I have to square this. How many terms do I get when I square a binomial? Three. The first term squared plus 2 times the first times the second plus the second term squared.
Sorry.
I know you're joking. So 5x squared plus 12x plus 9. Okay, number one, accomplished. I have a function that will give us the distance between any point on the line and the origin. What do I do now? Not the function. Differentiate first. Very good. So then I have d prime of x equals 1 over 2 the square root of 5x squared plus 12x plus 9 multiplied by 10x plus 12. Do we agree with the derivative? What do I have to do now with the derivative? You already told me. Perfect. So d prime of x equals 0. It's a fraction. How can this be 0? Only if, and you tell me what to write and I'll write it. 10x plus 12 equals 0. 10x equals negative 12 or x equals negative 1.2. So I haven't convinced you yet, but I know my point now. The point will be A of coordinates negative 1.2, comma, 2 times 1.2, I have to plug it in to get the y coordinate. 2 times 1.2, negative 1.2 is negative 2.4, and plus 3 is 0.6. Correct me, please. Make sure that I'm getting 0.6. So I claim that the point has to be at negative 1.2, comma 0.6. So actually the point is right here with the distance from the origin the smallest. Am I getting 0.6?
I eyeball that too.
Yeah, no, you can't. Yes, you can say it's probably here, but I intentionally didn't want to do that. It's a point on the line and then I have to find, okay, am I getting 0.6, anyone? So one more time, 2 times this,
2.4
it's negative 2.4, and plus 3 is 0.6. Correct. Okay, very good. But I haven't convinced you yet. So I have to write...
It's kind of convincing.
No, I have not convinced you yet. I'm trying to convince you right now. So let's plug in 0 in all this. So obviously it's positive and then negative. Because when I plug in negative 5, this is negative. So this is definitely... so at 0 is 12.
12 over 6.
Is it the closest point to the origin?
Oh, because I see what I did? I put 0 on this side, that's why. Where is 0?
Right.
So that's why this is the positive. When with 0, the it's positive. And with, so.
So how did you get 0 on?
That's it. That's my point. But when you write the signs, then you realize what mistake you made. I have to let it dry.
Same word.
Yes, what is the question? Yes, yes, because it looks like this, as we know. Negative, positive.
What's on the left, though?
Negative infinity. Negative infinity plus 12 is negative. This is always positive. I'm not going to even bother with it.
Zero, again.
0 on the right hand side. 0 plus 12 is 12. That's why it's positive.
Can you give me 0? Maybe 1.2.
Are you talking about this?
No.
This one? Because this value is the critical number that makes the derivative 0.
Did you just put that 0 on the right hand side just
by mistake? I forgot that this was negative. I cannot put 0 on the left hand side if this is a negative number. It has to
so
be on
just
the right.
Putting 0 there just
to plug in a number. Exactly.
It has nothing to
just
do
to
with
show just to show that this is positive and this exactly. Any questions?